Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. In today's video, we'll be discussing demand flexibility, which is the ability of electricity users, such as households, to modify their consumption to better match variable supply. It's also known as demand response or demand management. So we all know that the sun doesn't always shine and the wind doesn't always blow. And as I've spoken about before on this channel, the electricity grid needs to keep supply and demand in careful balance, or else there will be blackouts. Balancing supply and demand isn't a new problem. In the past, when grids were mostly dominated by large fossil fuel generators that couldn't reduce their output below a certain base load, we created off-peak pricing to shift consumption into the nights when there would otherwise have been a mismatch between too much supply and not enough demand. But now that we're starting to get a lot of variable renewables in the mix, it's not so easy to set off-peak pricing when that time might need to change every day depending on the weather. Here in Australia, the most challenging time for our electricity grid is usually during heat waves when everyone has their air conditioner running. In different climates, it may be on cold mornings when everyone turns the heating on and has hot showers, turns the kettle on. Or when everyone gets home from work and starts cooking dinner, giving kids baths, and maybe plugging in their electric vehicles. If there isn't a lot of generation at these times of peak usage, say because there isn't a lot of sun or wind at that time, then the wholesale price of electricity will increase to encourage generators to come online. Very large industrial users are exposed to these variable electricity prices, so they have some incentive to use less when prices are high. But smaller users, including households, typically don't see any difference in prices from hour to hour. I could easily turn my air conditioner off for a few hours if the grid was under stress, but there's no incentive for me to do that, and actually not even any way for me to know that the grid is struggling unless I make a point to watch the wholesale spot prices. So there's a potential improvement for the electricity system, but how to realize it? To give households a financial incentive to shift electricity use to times with more renewables, and to reduce or even switch to supplying the grid when there is less renewable electricity available, that would require a dynamic pricing system that is a whole lot more complicated than simply setting your hot water system to run overnight. I got in touch with Phil Steele, who is the Future Technologies Evangelist at Octopus Energy in the UK, to talk about their Agile plan and its dynamic tariff that varies with the wholesale price. I asked Phil for a quick summary of the challenges the grid is facing with increasing amounts of variable renewables being added, and how the Agile plan works within that challenging environment.
So there's a kind of a trend there. As the grid starts to see distributed renewable generation rather than large-scale monolithic energy generation, then the grid starts to become kind of stressed with how that renewable distributed energy is generated and how it's consumed by consumers. And of course, what we've done with Agile reflects the wholesale market. So it is engaging consumers in when energy is generated, what the wholesale price of energy is doing, and then how can they take part in that? And what we're seeing is, you know, we can influence behavior change in awareness of energy generation, energy consumption. The Agile price gets published sometime after 4 p.m. every day for the next day ahead. It runs 11 p.m. to 11 p.m. Some customers just simply know that the price will be high between 4 and 7 in the evening, and so try and avoid that. But others are configuring systems or using devices, washing machines, dryers and things, when the price is particularly low. There is also an API of the tariff as well, so application programming interface, getting one computer system to talk to another. So there are quite a large number of customers with solar battery systems who are storing their excess solar generation, but they're actually deciding, should that home battery system store when the Agile price is particularly low? So it's using the grid and storing grid energy as well as solar energy. But because we have the export version as well, when's the best time to actually export from the battery as well, rather than just simply supply back to the home as well? So there's a kind of trading process that's going on. And that it's really exciting just to see that kind of level of engagement, those consumers that are reacting to that.
And can they program their own algorithm to control that?
They can, yes. So because the API is public,
that's really cool.
then there are lots of customers, kind of amateur coders, if you like, that are experimenting with that API and creating their own system. So you could take something like a Raspberry Pi, connect a device to it, connect to our API and start programming things. So if you've got a hot water tank, why would I, might I program that to heat hot water at 5 p.m. because I want enough hot water for children's showers and baths at 7 or 8 in the evening? 5 p.m. is completely the wrong time. That's when the grid is under the most demand, and it happens to be when Agile is therefore at its highest. But if you can program that climate device and say, right, just give me 3/4 of a tank, because I know that's enough, by 8 p.m., then the system will just take care of that, because it's a store. You're able to store energy with a hot water tank.
What are the major appliances that you can connect? What are the big electricity users in your customers' homes?
A lot of the customers are kind of combining solar, battery, electric vehicle, and air source heat pumps as well.
So all these smart appliances, how much extra do they cost? What's the cost for consumers to kind of get into this?
There's no cost for a smart meter to the end consumer. There's an obligation to get large numbers of smart meters installed, and we're probably around about 50% of UK properties got smart meters now. Once you've got a smart meter, that allows us to do all these sorts of smart tariffs and things. So the sorts of appliances that customers are buying, electric vehicles, obviously, solar battery systems. The costs vary depending on the install size. So we have customers with 6 kilowatt peak output of solar panels, and perhaps a 6 to 10 kilowatt hour battery system on the property. And that might cost, say, £6,000 to £10,000 to have installed. More of the cost is actually the installation itself. And then air source heat pumps. Air source heat pumps run at around £10,000 install and kit cost at the moment as well. There is in some cases changes to radiators and pipework if you've got microbore, but those have always been looked at, and what's the best way of getting air source heat pumps installed, because I think we're going to see really big growth in heat pumps now as we move away from gas and want electrified heating.
Is there anything else major that you really need to hook up to the smart
system? A lot of the customers that I've spoken to with pools actually also have solar systems and things, and they're putting in batteries to store the solar energy to drive their swimming pools. But that's a very small segment of customers. I interact with customers that are looking at how to better control dishwashers, washing machines, and dryers and things. And at the moment, you can't really program them as such, and you can't connect them via an API. There's a couple of manufacturers who have Wi-Fi enabled their appliances and things, but I'd love to see more of that kind of connectivity so we can apply the control to them. And it's so cool to see that customers will get up at 1 a.m. to put an appliance or something on to take advantage or whatever.
EVs. Just going to say, I assume that these are people that have programmed things to work automatically, because there is nothing that would get me out of bed at 1 a.m. No amount of cheap electricity. Yeah. What's the benefit? How much are people saving from, in an extreme case and in an average case, say?
There's one case I know of. It's a housing association property in Lancashire. And This property had solar battery system installed on the property. They're on Agile, and the battery system is charging up from the grid when the Agile prices are low, and it's discharging when the Agile rates are high. And it was a bungalow, so a single floor, terraced, so neighbours either side, and it was one guy living on his own. And so he ended up close to 95%. Reduction in his energy consumption with that solar battery system and his consumption profile. Other customers I've seen, and it does tend to be kind of the more EV and solar battery types of customers, but others I've seen are achieving averages of below 10 pence sometimes on Agile, and against a normal flat rate tariff of about 18 pence or so, then that's kind of 40-ish% reduction. You know, with Agile customers, we're seeing, although the prices have been high recently, customers getting averages of below 10 pence per kilowatt hour. That's been a bit higher than the last 6 months or so, because the wholesale price has been much, much higher recently. So we're probably looking at about 16 pence or so average that customers are getting.
And then what about horror stories? Like, everybody saw the Texas freeze last year, and I think some people got thousands of dollar electricity bills.
We don't have that kind of level of extreme on the wholesale market as Texas has had there. But even so, the agile rate, if we just let the algorithm run, could price customers at £1 a kilowatt. So hence we cap it at 35 pence between 4 and 7. So we don't cause issues with customers having really high bills because of freak weather events.
Yeah, I find that really interesting that it is, you're not telling people what to do.
You can either centralize command and control, right? Let's just have everybody on flat rate tariffs. Nobody's aware of what the wholesale market's doing. And you try and get your flat rate tariff as low as you can by incentivizing customers to use things at different times, but not through the tariff. And the kind of, you wouldn't have that level of engagement. You know, if we're looking at trying to get to 100% renewables, we already are a 100% renewable company, but you look at the trying to get the grid onto 100% renewables, trying to get away from that generation. You've got to engage customers. You've got to give them the choice and let them understand what impact they're having and how they're consuming energy and when they're consuming it and where the energy is coming from. One of the things I'm a big fan of is community energy schemes. So we launched a tariff January this year called Fan Club. So we own, we acquired two wind generators. But what we offer with Fan Club was customers in a local postcode near that wind generator get a 20% discount when the wind generator is generating electricity and 50% when the wind speed is exceeding a certain value. So then, you know, you're engaging customers in awareness of what that wind generator is doing locally that they can see on the top of the hill.
I just want to come back to something else you mentioned, that one of your biggest success story was in some community housing, right? Because that's one thing that people bring up as a, you know, there's some aspect of it that's fair enough that, you know, all these renewable schemes that people are bringing in are, you know, mostly benefiting rich households and sometimes can be seen to contribute to higher costs for people that can't afford it and leading to fuel poverty. So, do you have anything else to say about how this kind of, you know, demand flexibility can be helping communities keep prices down?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you're right, because what happens is it's the wealthy that are perhaps gaining the benefit at the moment. If I've got a Tesla Powerwall and a car, and I've got onto the Tesla tariff that's 11p input, 11p
and
export.
Pool heater.
Yeah. So I've got onto that kind of. I've got the ability to invest in that technology and therefore get the best tariffs from us. That's kind of, you know, it's not right in the sense that those that could benefit most are not getting the benefit. So it's really encouraging to see social housing providers and other industry players in that space that are looking at how to invest on those sorts of properties and things. Benefit large communities.
It's really complicated, right? But I mean, I think the electricity grid is already complicated. But that's one of the other things that people say to me when I talk about, yeah, like vehicle to grid or anything else like that. It's like, oh, this is way too complicated. It'll never work. And what would your answer to that be? How would you manage the complexity?
I mean, if you look at it is complex. I mean, a lot of what we depend on is smart meters. And if you read some of our blogs, you'll see where we've had smart meter issues and how we've had to deal with those. So we have to kind of overcome those sorts of issues, but it's so important that we have access to things like half hourly reads, because it's only when we've got that data that we can start to apply some of this technology. I can tell you a little bit about the May bank holidays as well. We had very strong winds, and some of the agile price would go negative, but of course that only affects the few tens of thousands of customers on the agile tariff and not the rest of our flat rate fixed tariff customers. And it happened again by a pure weather fluke that the following bank holiday Monday at the end of May also had very strong wind as well. So we ran the event and suggested customers consume energy, and we would pay them to consume energy for a two-hour period. So we applied a credit back onto their accounts. But tens of thousands of customers literally engaged with us on that program. Because they wanted to, and they realised what we were trying to do, and it kind of proves that there's a future in time use tariffs, smart meter, half hour data, balancing the grid, making the grid cope with distributed, very intermittent renewable energy, as well as the increasing electricity demand as we start to turn towards all electric vehicles and electric heating and things. You know, the demand is going to go up. So it's going to be really exciting watching this technology evolve.
Thanks for that, Phil. One of the aspects that I like the most about Octopus is how enthusiastic their customers are. It clearly goes way beyond just cost saving. Because, for example, the customers who are waking up at 1 a.m. to turn appliances on during negative price events, I mean, they're probably getting paid about 50 pence for that. Octopus Agile customers are clearly excited about being able to help with the clean energy transition. And I would imagine they're probably also unusually technically savvy, able to understand some pretty complex aspects of the electricity markets, and many of them programming their own algorithms to get their household consumption working just the way they like. I do wonder how much this could really scale beyond these enthusiastic early adopters. Because for consumers who don't want to or don't have the ability to manage so much complexity themselves, then the alternative is probably to allow an external party to control your home's electricity usage. I don't know how many people are going to be keen on that. An example is in Queensland, where air conditioner owners can get a cash incentive to allow the electricity network to turn their air conditioning down when the network's under stress. And then another example of a simple system, but without anyone else controlling what happens in your house, is California's Flex Alerts. That's a call for consumers to voluntarily conserve electricity when they predict a shortage. So these schemes are helping, but probably not on such a large scale relative to the potential that's there. And I'm not sure I can ever really imagine it becoming a large part of the solution. I think that part of the problem is that when the traditional utilities or electricity retails are running these schemes, it feels a bit like they're asking customers to go out of their way to solve their problems for them. And I don't think enough consumers are going to care about helping the utilities or necessarily to trust the utilities to control appliances in their own homes. So I think that some of the other work that Octopus is doing is a really good step in the right direction here to make sure that customers are brought along, to feel a certain amount of ownership. I especially like the community housing projects that they were involved in, and I would love to see a lot more of these. So overall, I am really excited about the possibility for demand flexibility in household, but I'm moderating that excitement against the reality that not everyone is as much of a clean energy nerd as I am. However, I know that many of you watching are probably the exact kind of person who'd be an enthusiastic early adopter of this. So if you're not already doing it, I would encourage you to check out what kinds of flexible tariffs might be available in your area. Please let me know in the comments if you're on a flexible tariff and what your experience with it has been. I always need to thank my Patreon community for their support, which for this video included some really good background information from some of the team. If you would like to help shape the future of Engineering with Rosie, you could join the Patreon community and get access to longer cuts of some of the interviews, as well as have input on future video topics, suggestions for interview questions, and general chat discussion with a bunch of other people interested in renewable energy technologies. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.